little note on the email that this is not for broadcast or publication, but we'll let that go on this occasion. I'm relieved to say that Mr. Banderas is indeed in northern Spain, as we're about to embark on a film called Altamira, which shoots in Cantabria next week. So if you want me to continue to be glamorous, I can tell you that from here we go straight to the plane to be in San Sebastian tomorrow for the premiere of another movie called Tigers, which I'll tell you about tomorrow. And the idea that I would be standing here saying things like this certainly didn't occur to me when I was sitting where you are during those amazing years when I was here. I've had a chance today to go around the school to meet some of the boys to see the developments. And you know, when you first are asked to do something like this, you think, well, yeah, it's a great honor, I'm very flattered. I think what I realized today was that you, even though I haven't been here for a very long time, I immediately felt part of that kind of organic process of a school which goes on. And, you know, I felt 16 again, talking to the drama group this afternoon. And I think you realize just what a huge part an establishment like this plays in your life. There's some very important people in the room today. Michael Hoffman, a great friend of mine. Ross Warburton, who became a great friend, and my parents. But I really should start with the school. I've just had the pleasure of seeing two of my old teachers again, Mr. Taylor and Mr. Shaw. Brought back a memory of Mr. Shaw. Mr. Shaw is one of those annoying teachers who has that kind of natural authority that you sort of can never mess with. And you know, we all know that boys do their best to give teachers a hard time. You couldn't do that with him. But my reports did sometimes say that I was quite a mature pupil, but we had this most juvenile game, which began with people seeing if they could, while the teacher was writing on the blackboard, stand on the desk and stand there for 5 seconds. And if you did that, you got a point. That developed into trying to put your chair on your desk and climbing on your desk and standing on the chair on the desk and standing there for 5 seconds. And if you did that, you got more points. And there was very little more hilarious than when a teacher would inadvertently turn around and find a boy standing on a chair on the desk in the room. And of course, somebody had to keep score, which I very foolishly did in the back of my physics exercise book. And one day I got a message that Mr. Shaw would like to see me outside the staff room, which is never a good call. And he was keen to know what the markings in the back of my exercise book referred to. I have never been as humiliated as that in my life. How would you explain to a serious physics teacher what that game was, what had been happening? Not in his lessons, because you never dare do it in his lessons. And of course, he did that awful thing that teachers do, which is they didn't really have to say very much because I was so humiliated. I'd like to think I never got myself into a situation like that again, but I would like to take the opportunity to apologize 35 years later. The questions I'm asked most in my professional life are usually, will you introduce me to Colin Firth or will you introduce me to Scarlett Johansson? Beyond that, they are, what does a producer do? And how did you come from reading physics, studying physics here, to becoming a producer? I'm going to try and answer that question a little bit over the course of the next little while. My job, the easiest description of my job is that it's about telling stories. Specifically as a producer, it's sometimes about enabling stories to be told in one of the most complicated mediums that you can imagine. It is genuinely a creative industry. It combines art, it combines creativity, it combines a lot of industry because it takes millions of dollars to make a film. And so you have to put all these pieces together in deciding, but it all starts with the story. So when I thought about speaking to you tonight, I couldn't really help but look at my own story here and try and analyze it the way that I would analyze any story. Because I've made quite a few true stories into films. I've been told thousands of amazing true stories, and the one thing I've learned is that very few of them should ever be made into a film. So you have to decide if the story is worth it, and you have to work on structure, you have to work on characters, you have to work on story, but most of all, you have to work on tension. Because the one thing that we all want when we sit in front of a movie screen is that sense that we've got to know what's going to happen next. It's the hardest single thing to do in storytelling, is to get that sense that people have got to know what's happening. They've got to suspend their disbelief, but you've got to keep them hooked. So, I thought back to many years ago, a 10-year-old boy arriving at the school and literally peeking in through those doors at the back there at the extraordinary scale of this, nothing like he'd ever seen before. He's there with his mum, he's got wonderful parents, they're not particularly rich, but this is a school that means that if you get a scholarship, you might be able to come here. So, it's a movie, so there'll probably be lots of shots of just how extraordinary this place is and how intimidating it is. And then he's led into a room, just along the corridor, and interviewed by a man who seems extremely old and is wearing a gown, and is terrifying. And this man kind of looks at him for a while and says, "Which is heavier, ice or water?" And the boy sits there and thinks, "I'm supposed to be quite good at science," and says, "I haven't the faintest idea," and it's a disaster. It's over before it begins, and you can see his mum looking at him. He's paralysed, and thinks he might as well just walk out. And then this very old man looks to him and says, "Have you ever seen a frozen pond?" And the boy thinks about it and goes, "Yeah, ice and frozen. And the ice floats on the water, so the ice must be lighter than the water." And the old man smiles at him, and they start to talk. And he realizes he's just been thrown this lifeline. And suddenly, he sees what this place might be, that it might be a place that actually could help you to learn. And because it's a movie, you think, okay, well, this is what's going to happen now. So, what do you do next? You can, if you like, you can just sort of tell the story. Probably you go back to his primary school, and there's the headmaster holding a letter and smiling. And the boy knows that everything's changed. And that's, I guess, what we would call a movie moment, one of those moments where you've been told a story and something changes. And now you want to know what's going to happen next. But it's quite a small story, and you might have seen something like it before. So maybe we'll go back earlier. If you're going to tell the story of me, let's go back earlier. 1945. There is an RAF navigator with a bunch of guys, and they are preparing to head out to Japan to support the land invasion of Japan. And they're drinking beer and they're chatting away, but they pretty much know that if what they've heard about the campaign that's coming, they're probably going to die. And so this guy thinks back to the beginning of the war. He's 17, and war's just broken out, and he goes to his dad, and he says, "Dad, you've got to sign this piece of paper. Because if you sign this piece of paper, I can join up right now and go off with all my mates and get into this war. And if you don't sign it, I've got to wait a year, and I'll mess up the fine." And his dad looks at him and says, "I'm not going to sign it. I'm sorry." And at that point, the guy hates his father because he won't give him this opportunity and it's all going to go horribly wrong. We go back to 1945, and just as they're flying off, the news comes through that an atomic bomb has been dropped on Japan and the war's over, and he's survived it. Now, we know that if his dad had signed that piece of paper, he would have been in the war that much earlier. He'd have probably been in D-Day. He'd have probably died. My physics teacher here, he died at D-Day. And now you've got a situation. How do you want to tell that story? Because if you want to do it the Hollywood way, then maybe we'll look at this scene, and suddenly you cut to the version where the granddad says, "Okay, I'll sign the piece of paper." And suddenly I don't exist anymore. My father was killed in the war. I don't exist. And that's a very interesting way to tell that movie. Or maybe you tell it a different way. Maybe you tell it as a love story. The guy comes home walks up his street, there's bunting, there's victory parades, he's survived the war, he comes home, and he knocks on the door of his house, and his dad answers. And it's a British movie, so granddad looks at my dad and just says, "You're back then." And probably that's all that needs to be said. And that man then goes on, realizes he's come home to a country that is bankrupt and exhausted and has barely survived this awful conflict. And he spent the years that I spent here and at Oxford and at the BBC as part of the war. And now he has to build a life from nothing. And he does it through night school, and then he meets this amazingly beautiful woman. And they get married. And a few years later, that woman brings me to that door. And then maybe we've got a journey that really works. That story could be told so many different ways. And the reason that I think, I've been asking, we've been talking about when you get interested in telling stories, started for me up in Seablock. Brian Gallagher, who was injured at D-Day, he was at the Cavendish Lab in Cambridge just after the war. And he told us stories which I thought were so much better than this literature we were reading down there. Because he told us stories about the guys who were making the atomic bombs at Los Alamos and how on the morning, that dawn of the first test when they were finally going to press the button to see if this first atomic bomb was going to explode, they were having bets. Is this thing going to go off? Is it going to go off and be so big that it will ignite the atmosphere and destroy the world? And I was astonished that scientists could have been part of something like that. And as he told me those stories, I thought, okay, this is where I need to go, because these are the best stories, and the only way into that world is to read physics, to read maths, so that you might understand how the universe works. That was a very precocious 16-year-old choice, but it took me into those stories. And of course, in the version I've just been telling you, if we were at Los Alamos waiting for that first test, and there's the countdown and everybody's looking nervous, I need you to be thinking, let the bomb work, let the bomb go off. Because if the bomb goes off, the war's over, and Andy lives. You tell those stories, and I know how to hold you in my hand in the movies to make that work. But it's all about which way you decide to tell those stories. And most of the choices that you have to make are not about, is the world full of great stories? It's about how do you tell them in such a way that people will be moved. Now, how we got to this point of trying to understand this is still completely fascinating to me. There are certain rules in storytelling. And so if I continue my story, I heard the stories here, I decided to read physics, I decided that, you know, I'd go that route. But stories also need setbacks and obstacles, and so far it all sounds a bit perfect. I'm not sure I believe a word of it. So you have to then wind on to the 17-year-old boy here, who by this point is kind of looking over there quite a bit, and is also in a band. And so there are two much more interesting things going on in life than studying physics. One of them is that he's in a band called Orpheus, which isn't actually a bad thing as far as looking that direction is concerned. But there's also another band here called Airlift, which has Ross Warburton and various people. And there's a big kind of conflict going on there. So his very first piece of producing is to actually start something called the Christmas Song Contest, which took place in the miniature theatre, which allowed us to bring those bands into school. I believe we now have the Battle of Bands on a much bigger scale, but back then it was really radical and allowed that competition to go. And I discovered to my horror today that the miniature theatre is no longer there. So when I have my huge Hollywood hit and get very rich, I will restore it. But I've also been asked to throw out a gauntlet to Airlift to say that I will reform Orpheus. If they will reform Airlift, it will bring them to the Battle of the Bands in the next 2 years. That's a challenge. But back at that time, when I was here, and so much more interested in girls and rock and roll, there are some pretty classic movie scenes which I'm not terribly proud of. One of them might be us coming off stage in Manchester one night, drinking beer, and somebody saying to me, "Don't you have an exam tomorrow?" And getting home at about 3 o'clock in the morning to find the mother who sat there watching that interview, the mother who hoped that I might get here, greeting me knowing that I'd just thrown it all away. 4 hours before my second further maths A-level, and there we were, just being dreaming of being rock and roll stars. At which point, probably that character in a movie, you've decided you should hate him, and I have to throw up to keep the movie going, a chance of redemption. And I remember it in the most extraordinary way, that having messed up the A-levels, this was back in the days when we had the extreme, and I'd done O-levels a year early, and A-levels a year early, and we had third year Oxbridge. And despite having messed up the A-levels, there was a huge amount of support here, and we used to work up in that tower room. And again, if this is a movie, everything goes very quickly. I've never worked so hard in my life. I had huge support from my physics teachers who said, like, they couldn't decide whether I was just panicking or really working hard. And you used to do Oxbridge entrance exams up in that tower room. And I remember sitting there, and as if the pen wasn't moving, the pen was just going crazy. The equations were flowing. And I went down to Oxford for an interview, thinking it would be a bit of a chat. And instead, my physics tutor, to be, gave me a marker pen and a whiteboard and asked me to derive Bohr's equation for the energy states of the hydrogen atom. And this is the bit which I would never put in a movie, because I did. And if I put that in a film, I don't think you would believe it. A couple of weeks later, I was down in the tuck shop, as it then was, down in the corner, and the sergeant came across to me and said there was a telegram for me in the office. I'd never had a telegram in my life. And again, you have to decide which way you want to tell the story. I can walk across the quad, I remember it so clearly, walking from that door across the lodge, thinking if it's a telegram, they're not going to send a telegram to say no. Or you might go the other way. The man who made something of himself, having put all his life, early life into the war, might just go to work the next day, sympathize with his boss that his son failed to get into Cambridge, and just casually mention that his son had got a scholarship to Oxford. I don't know, there's many ways to tell it. But I had a second chance, which most of us don't get, which took me to Oxford. Amazing as this school is, it still doesn't prepare you completely for the shock of arriving down there amongst all those people from Eton and London and all the rest of it. But I had the great fortune to, on the first night, knowing that my deadly rival from Airlift was going to the same college, think I might avoid him, but meeting him and becoming great friends with him and really being shown a lot about how the world works by him. And then this American postgraduate student arrived, who astonishingly is here tonight, Michael Hoffman. Two things happened. One was that the most unlikely combination of events meant that the thing that really changed my life was the fact that I had been in the band. They had a Beach Boys tribute band which needed musicians. I told them they needed a bass player and joined them. And the second was that Mike directed in the front quarter or in college a production of A Midsummer Night's Dream. We were talking to the drama group earlier. You know how it is with Shakespeare. Sometimes you sit and watch a production of Shakespeare that is impenetrable. You think, I have no idea what these characters are. I have no idea what this story is. None of this language makes sense to me. Mike's production was one of those productions that you sat and thought it must have been rewritten in contemporary language, because it was just hilarious and moving, and you felt as if you were just completely wrapped inside. And watching that production, I knew that I wanted a part of that. And so somebody had the idea that we should make a film. The assumption was that, you know, we try and make a short film. But Mike and his colleague Rick, both being American, had the ambition to say, nobody likes short films. What do you want to do with a short film? So let's make a movie. We're students. What is it? What's the difference? So being Oxford, we held drinks parties for the rich students, fleeced them 50 quid or 100 quid or sometimes even 500 quid, and raised about £20,000, which gave us potentially a budget to get something done. But we also went to see one of our tutors, who said, you should talk to John. He was terribly keen on that sort of thing. And John turned out to be John Schlesinger, who was the Oscar-winning director of Midnight Cowboy and Yanks and Marathon Man. So we went to see John. And he gave me, I think, the single most extraordinary piece of advice, where he simply said to us, there's only one camera. You can work the rest out from there. Which actually is completely true. If you want to make a movie, we went and watched 100 films and simply thought, well, okay, there must be a camera at the back because you're on me, and we need a camera there that's going to show a shot of him, and then there's a cutaway down there, and there's a camera there. We literally just had to figure it out from there. And I saw Schlesinger years and years later at ridiculously glamorous pre-Oscar batch, where he was talking, as you do, to Jack Nicholson and Shirley MacLaine. Except that Jack Nicholson had his nose firmly down the cleavage of the actress that he brought with him. And I reminded John of this story, and he said, he laughed and said, of course, nowadays the schedules are so terrible, you need five cameras at least or you'll never get anything done. Which is a technical joke, but it was time to drop a few names. We had a group of people. This is, you know, so long ago that there weren't many film schools, there weren't so many media courses, so we were able to just kind of go down to Twickenham Studios and beg and borrow equipment, and then put together a bunch of actors who happened to be at Oxford, including one very beautiful boy with questionable acting skills called Hugh Grant. And we made a film called Privileged, which was a melodrama, a love story, set in Oxford, which Mike, as the director, properly tries to tell me is a terrible film. But it was a film that was distributed, a film that was shown by the BBC, but most of all, it was a film that we made. And the hardest thing about learning how to make films is that it's impossible to practice it. You can't just go out and make a film. It's easier now, because there is digital equipment and all the rest. But I come back to story. You have to figure out just how hard it is to really tell a story. And even if that film was no masterpiece, it got us through the whole process once of making a film. And it introduced us to that strange magic of the film world. You know, there are 1,000 old Boltonians who are better qualified to tell you the amazing things that they do. But because I make movies, somehow we're all more interested. And part of that mythology comes from just that process of telling stories that connect to you in a darkened room. For us, part of it becomes when you have actually put all this equipment together and you've got those actors and you call for quiet and somebody says roll sound and you have that clapperboard, which is a piece of mythology, and somebody says action and something happens. And we were completely and utterly hooked by that process. It was incredibly difficult to get this film done, but we were hooked. I was delighted when I told Mr. Shaw earlier on that I'd used my engineering qualifications to get into the BBC. He scoffed very naturally. I was so pleased to see he still valued my skills as a physicist. Getting into the BBC through the back door was a very good idea. I had 3 thrilling years working in television news as an editor. And that was 1981 to 1984. So I was the one sitting there when the footage of Goose Green came in from the Falklands. I was there at the beginning of the miners' strike, just as the person editing the pictures that you saw on your TV news. And of course, Kate Adie and I were responsible for the news coverage of Charles and Di's wedding, which was about as memorable as you get, because we went out the night before, overslept, and when I went into the edit suite the next morning, late, Kate Adie had already laced up the very complicated machinery and saved me. But during that period, we just wanted to get back to making films. And making a student film, you're focused on the mechanics of making a film. To step out into the real world, suddenly you're dealing with millions of pounds and business in the biggest possible way. We were able to make some independent films, but I think to give you some hint of what producing actually is, I'm going to jump on to the year 2000. Three stories started in the year 2000. One was the story of Eric Lomax. We read a book about a man who was tortured on the Burma Railway. I'm lying, it was actually 1999. I have footage of Eric taking his Red Edinburgh, this video of him signing a book. So 1999 was when we first read that story. There was also a story about a young Pakistani salesman who discovered he was selling baby formula that was killing babies and decided to take on the Nestle Corporation. That was in 2000. And I premiered that movie in Toronto 4 weeks ago. The other moment was that the girl who was the script supervisor on Privileged, introduced to me by Michael, and who's now my wife, came downstairs and said, holding this novel, and said, "You have to read this." I looked at this manuscript, which was Girl with a Pearl Earring. And I said, "Okay, I'll put it on my pile." She said, no, you have to read it now, which is not something she'd ever done to me before. So I read this book. She described that she read it breathlessly, that she simply devoured it page by page. And I understood why. Because here was a story which was, on the face of it, a very domestic story. A maid in a household in Delft in Holland in 1665. And there were certainly no car chases, there were no explosions. There was just the story of a young girl who dreamed of something and who was in great danger because of the nature of the story. It was beautiful, it cried out to be put on film. But at the same time, I knew how difficult it would be, because to pitch that story in Hollywood to try and get people hooked on it, people were going to say, it just seems very small to me. Somebody did one point later that actually said to me, nothing a few canal chases wouldn't solve. But what you have to do at that point is to try and figure out the commercial equation of something which is an apparently beautiful piece of art. There would have been no point trying to make that film unless it could be mounted on a scale that would bring to you, the audience, what you felt when you read that book. So you're walking into the world of one of the greatest painters of all time. You're walking into a period world. The movie is going to cost quite a lot of money. And the lead role is a 17-year-old girl. And you start to do the sums. Because if you're going to try and find what I thought at that time was probably about $12 million to make that film, then you have to figure out who's going to pay for that, who's going to take the risk. And many, many years ago, you know, when Sam Spiegel was producing Bridge on the River Kwai, he paid for the film. You know, he raised it from investors, but basically the producer paid for the film. Sadly, I didn't yet, and still don't, and probably never will, have $12 million. So you have to figure out how you can do it. And that is about assessing people's risk. We have around Europe certain government schemes that can provide a bit of money. We can work sometimes with other countries, but at some point you have to sell that film to distributors around the world who will look at what you've got and give you money in advance to make the film. Now, the problem with films is that you might have a script, but most films, once they're made, are terrible. Thousands of films get made. The most terrifying statistics I can give you is I was sat on a plane to the Sundance Film Festival once and spoke to one of the programmers who looked at all of the submissions, and she said to me, we had 5,000 submissions this year, and of those 5,000 submissions, we will be able to select maybe 150 films. And of those 150 films, maybe 5 will get distributors at the festival. 5,000 get made, 5 actually get shown. Now, a lot of those films nobody wanted, but at the same time, that's the kind of risk that you're asking people to take. So what you have to do is you have to mitigate people's risks. You have to find ways, first of all, to persuade them about the story, but then you have to give them something they can work with, which means, at the simplest level, stars and directors. Got a big name director and stars, then people kind of go, okay, when somebody says to me, what do? I'm a film producer. First question is, anything I've seen? Second question is, who's in it? It's how audiences can start to assess whether you're going to pay your £10 at the box office to buy something you don't know what it is yet. So, at that point in the proceedings, Mike Newell, who was one of the biggest directors, Mike who directed Four Weddings and a Funeral, went on to do one of the Harry Potter movies, was one of the biggest directors, and he called me up and said, I've read this book, I believe you have the rights. Would you think about me being the director? Which is not a moment that happens very often. So I said to Mike, I'll definitely think about you. Can you come over, let's have a cup of tea. And he came over. Mike is wonderful, he's terribly big and British and excited and enthusiastic. And he said, how did you get the rights? I said, well, you know, we got the author in. And he said, well, I got the author in, but she sold them to you. And what we had actually managed, I think the winning point with her is we'd explained to her how we understood the story. But we also said, they will never have sex. Because in the book is all about this forbidden relationship between Vermeer and this girl. And the Hollywood people who come to her kind of assumed that, you know, that relationship would have to go much further into the book. And she trusted us that we would tell it the way it needed to be told. We had finance from people who'd made a film that we'd just done called Hillary and Jackie, but it depended on getting these numbers. We got a call from them and they said that Kate Hudson was very interested in playing the role. Now, Kate Hudson is Goldie Hawn's daughter. She wasn't at that point known for her profound acting depth. We said, okay, well, it's not really where we want to be. But so, no, Kate, listen to me. Why don't we say Kate wants to do the film? What they really meant was Kate is going to do the film. So Mike and I went off to meet Kate with my wife, the screenwriter, going, do not come back telling me that Kate Hudson is going to do the film. We arrived at the restaurant. Kate came in with a headscarf on, looking very Dutch, very girl with a pearly. She sort of did a little bit of this to us. And by the time the third bottle of wine had gone down, I staggered into bed at 2 o'clock in the morning, went, she's just wonderful. My wife fortunately didn't leave me, but we did agree that Kate playing Greet in the film got the film made, and Mike was completely convinced he could find a way to make that work with her, it'll be great, we'll get it done. We went down that road. The financiers were putting up the money, supposedly. We went and scouted locations in Holland. We started to put the crew together, we started to build sets. And when we were about 3 weeks from filming, I was sitting, and I'm sorry, this will sound terribly film producery, but I was sitting at Universal Studios in Los Angeles. We were negotiating with them to make a big comedy that they were really excited about, and Hugh Grant was going to be in it. And we just had big meetings about that, and then I was going to fly to Holland to start shooting Girl with a Girl there, and they thought I was amazing, doing this big Hollywood film, about to go off and do this incredibly classy British movie, Dutch, but it's the same to America. And they said, just use the, you know, your flight's not for a few hours, just use the boardroom. So I sat there looking out over the studios and thinking, you know, this is really not bad. And the phone rang, and Mike Newell said, she's not going to bloody do it. And I said, what are you talking about? And he said, Kate has decided not to do the film. So I called Kate's agent and said, but we have a contract. And he said the immortal words, fortunately, nobody is looking at it that way. What was happening was that the financing company was trying to float their company on this Frankfurt Stock Exchange for a hugely inflated amount of money, and somehow this film didn't quite fit the profile. And so as far as they were concerned, easy come, easy go. But they didn't know how to get out of it. Kate Hudson had a rock and roller boyfriend who had a rehab problem, and she suddenly didn't want to go to Europe for 3 months to make this film. So the agent called the financier, said, we've got a problem with Kate. The financier said, that might work for us. And I get the call, and by this point, we're about $500,000 into this film, with the promise every day from the financiers that cash flow is just on its way, the check is literally in the post. I fly back to England, meet with Mike, and decide what we're going to tell people on this Monday morning, this Tuesday morning. We go for a little walk around Soho. I said, look, I'll go and talk to the key crew in the office. You be in your office, we'll take the next step. I'm just starting to explain that the movie is basically on hold. Mike Newell comes into the office and says, I think you need to put the television on. And as he put the television on, the second plane at the World Trade Center. And the world fell apart. This was 2 o'clock on 9/11. Now, if that's not enough to put you off making movies, as a combination of events, the movie fell apart, we were $500,000 in debt, and all of this stemmed from making a stupid decision, which was to cast Kate Hudson in the movie in the first place, because, and actually, to be honest, to cast Mike Newell as the director, because none of these things came from the way that we wanted to tell the story. We'd allowed ourselves to make decisions based on the wrong choices. So, we pretty much grew up at that point, that if you're going to tell stories, they have to be stories that come from you, they have to be stories where you make decisions that make sense to you, and you don't get pushed around by other people to make decisions that make commercial sense on paper. The greatest disservice that is done to all of you as movie audiences, you'll never know that, because they are moments when terrible movies appear in front of you, because people have made choices for all the wrong reasons in order to get that movies can get made, in order that somebody can get a role in something. And you have to realize that nothing will work in this business unless it makes pure sense to you. So I simply said, okay, we're not going to go with big name directors, we're not going to be told what we're going to do, but we are going to make this film. And so, you don't just call agents and say, you know, I want to meet Daniel Day-Lewis, I want to meet such and such. You have to work really hard to get known by these agents. You have to find ways to get to cast. And so we went to Los Angeles and we sat with the agents and we said, you know what? Ralph Fiennes is going to play Vermeer in this film. And we will not cast the girl in this film unless they read with Rafe, unless they do workshops with Rafe, and we can really be sure that the chemistry between these people is right. And we just made those rules up, and we said, it's up to you if you want to send your clients to these meetings or not. But I had a very good-looking young director by this point, very charming English boy, who I really trusted because he'd come up from my company. And we started to meet these girls. Olivia, my wife, called up and said, you have to meet this girl, Scarlett Johansson. I've seen her in, you know, this little movie, Ghost World, and she's here. So we met Scarlett, and she was hilarious. She was just on her way to a baseball game in New York with Spike Lee. She had no idea what this film was about. She could not have been less right for the role in that particular moment. There was something about her. We called her back in. She worked with Rafe, and she was amazing. And she knew she'd been amazing. And we, the previous day, seen Kirsten Dunst, who was also pretty amazing, but Kirsten Dunst was just about to be out in Spider-Man. Scarlett was nobody. But on this occasion, at least, we trusted both roles, so we went with Kirsten. And broke Scarlett's heart. 4 months later, I got a phone call saying that Kirsten wasn't going to do the film. The agents had decided that Spider-Man was going to be huge, he was going to be the next Julia Roberts, and suddenly this little art movie in Hollywood was not the right thing, and so she wasn't going to do it. So then I simply said to my various backers, we'll find a way to get the budget down, we'll find a way to make this right, but we saw in that room that Scarlett Johansson was the right person for this role, and that's what we're going to make the film. You can be with us or not. So I called Scarlett and said, we've made it happen, you can do it. And in expletives that I will delete for this august gathering, she told me to go away. Because she knew how good she'd been in that room, she knew she was right for this role, and most of all, she knew that we knew that. And yet we had once again allowed ourselves to be pulled in the wrong direction. So she made us fly out to Vancouver where she was shooting. We had dinner with her, she went off for 3 days. She basically just punished us for having made the wrong decision. And then finally, she called me up and said, we're going to make a great movie, which was lovely. And then Ralph Fiennes pulled out. It kind of is the way that the world of movies work. You know, we describe it sometimes as those little puzzles you get in Christmas crackers where there are 8 balls and 8 holes, we've got to somehow get them all in the right place. There was probably about 100 of those little balls. I went to my UK distributor and explained that we didn't have Rafe anymore, and he said, who else could you get? And I said, well, you know, we've always wanted Colin Firth, but Mike Newell never liked him. He said, well, can you get Colin Firth? Who at that point, of course, was not the Colin Firth of the King's Speech, Oscar and all that stuff. But Colin came in and met us, and I only discovered much, much later that I had the most unique experience with Colin Firth, which is that he came in, we chatted for 5 minutes, he said, do you want me for this? We said yes, he said, I'd love to do it, and that was that. And we finally then had that package, and it was the right package. And from that point on, it was as if we'd paid our dues for everything that we'd gone through. The actual shooting of the film was just delightful. We shot it in a, we built the whole house in Luxembourg. There was a backlot set that some Russians had made for a movie about Venice. They had built canals in a sort of industrial state and put Venice around it. So we just put Delft in front of that, and it meant that we could make it for not very much. When we walked into that set, people fainted. It was so extraordinary. And the movie did something remarkable, because it gave you that extraordinary moment. It was such a powerful drama, and it was so quiet that you could walk into the back of a movie theatre and watch the last 20 minutes, and it was as if nobody was breathing. They would simply stare, transfixed at the screen. And I really can't describe an experience quite like watching that. But the lessons that we learnt through that are what I hope we've continued to put into practice. Because during all that time, we'd been failing to get the Railway Man made. It was still the most extraordinary story I'd ever heard. But it was, again, a huge film. 21-year-old boy goes off to Singapore just in time for the fall of Singapore, shipped up to the Death Railway. A man who loved, a kid who was obsessed by trains, and the incredible irony of being made to be part of building the Death Railway. He was an engineer, so he was treated well, relatively. But what he did was to bring hope to the men who were being beaten and worked and starved to death by building radios and just bringing news from the outside world. And Eric Lomax said to me, you would hear that Hitler has been turned back at Stalingrad, and you would walk up to the line where they were building that railway and whisper that news, and 10,000 backs would straighten as people resolved to get through another day of this hell because the war was going the right way. And we had written a script which everybody who read it just kind of went, oh my God, this is the most extraordinary story. Or sometimes I would pitch to them, because again, in the very film producer way that we have, our year is actually marked by the markets. They're known as film festivals, but around the film festivals are markets. So I will be in Cannes, not because I'm on the red carpet doing lots of filmy stuff, because I'm in the market grafting, selling films, pitching films. And I would pitch that story. And I would go on from what I've told you, and I would say that those radios were found and terrible things were done to this man, and he came home a complete wreck. But there was this woman strong enough to know that this man she loved was still there inside, and she was going to find a way to get him out. And we would talk through this amazing opportunity he had to discover that the man who tortured him was still alive, and have the chance to go out and confront this man and try to kill him. And if I pitched the story to them, they would go, that's the most incredible story, we will make this film. But it never happened. We tried to cast it. This was a really expensive film. We tried to cast it. At one point, Ian McKellen was going to play the old Eric, and Ewan McGregor was going to play the young Eric. We thought that was a dead cert. Nobody would touch it. Sean Connery spent 6 months not reading it, and finally said he wouldn't want to play a loser like that. You'll notice I didn't do the accent. But we realized that everything I said at the beginning, it's not about the true story. The reason people loved the story when they heard it is because it's an amazing story. But the script we had simply told that story. It was about 4 hours long. You would have met Colin Firth about 2 hours in. And by half an hour from the end, you would know it ends in forgiveness. And so the tension that I talked about wasn't there. And so we went to see Eric again. We went to see Patty again. The book of this story barely mentions Patty the wife. But it seemed to me that the reason the story had such power is because the film, what the film is about is what war does to these people and what the millions of families have to cope with when they come home. And Patty's story did two things. It told that part of the story, but she was also the woman who married this man and then discovered that he was a mess. And she had to find out what was wrong with him. As soon as you put it into that structure, you have somebody who has to discover something, who has to fight with Eric's colleagues to reveal information, and then has to make a decision as to whether this man should be given the opportunity to go and meet this torturer, not knowing what will happen. And we challenged Eric. I said to Eric, kind of out of the blue once, if you're going to kill this guy, Eric, you must have figured out how to do it. And he looked at me for about 5 seconds and then described in very, very horrible detail the structure of the hyoid bones of the neck and what he was going to do. And suddenly, we found a way to put the tension into that story so that when you get to the beginning of Act 3 and Eric goes off to meet this man, you might know somewhere deep down that this is going to end well, but you cannot imagine how. And we went to meet Helen Bamber, who was somebody who had helped Eric, who was an expert, strangely, in torture. She spent her life working with torture victims, and she explained to us what torture really does to a man. That it's not about the pain, at least not later, but that what it does is it strips you of your humanity, it strips you of your dignity. If the woman you wanted to love you had seen what you became on that torture table, she could never love you. And once you start to investigate those ideas, then you understand why he's pushing her away, why she has to make that decision, and then you can start to understand how when he meets this man, he realizes he has the power to kill him, and you give him that power back, and suddenly the pain goes away a little because you're back in control. And so we rewrote the story around those ideas, and then suddenly that worked. And then I sent it to Colin Firth, who said, I love it, and spent 6 months not doing it, finally said, I thought about it, I can't possibly do it. And we talked him around, and it finally happened. All of these stories have to be powerful enough to sustain you through the years that it's going to take to get them made. So one of the drama students asked me this morning, how do you choose these stories? And the answer has to be that they have to be something which is going to sustain you through that time, that might actually, at the end, have those audiences at the edge of their seats. And I asked the headmaster along, I was trying to figure out where that instinct to tell stories comes from. And I think that what happened at this school, with the various, with the way, with the ethos of the school and the way that you're challenged to think around the subject, to think about what really matters in the subjects that you're telling, somehow, in that process, I became determined to tell those stories. And it's very strange to come back here because it makes you question all those things. All I know is that it all began here and that it's an incredible honour to be here tonight, and that having spoken for this long, I should throw this open to questions. So thank you very much.
Questions, and he's been very kind to say he will answer them. Obviously, in the hall, it's very difficult to make yourself heard. So what I would suggest is, if you ask a question reasonably loudly, I'll repeat what it is, so we all know to what question the answer is being given. So who has something to ask this evening? There's the question just here.
If you haven't got the second chance to drop, So
if that second chance to go off and study physics at Oriel, well, who could possibly think of what else you'd do? What would it have been?
I'll go back to the headmaster's script, which is that as long as you find a way to study physics, it opens every possible door in your life. I think that the lesson I learnt at that point, which triggered the kind of extraordinary explosion of effort that went on there, I hope that would have taken me somewhere. You know, there are two great humiliations in that story. One is the scorecard in the back of my physics book, and the other is that moment when I realised that I had just completely messed it up. And all you can do from that is learn from that. I have no idea. I mean, in many ways, that's the great thing about storytelling, is that I can play with those what-ifs. I could decide that I would have gone to another university, met other wonderful people, but it's that sliding doors moment when you simply can't tell. What came out of that second chance was meeting the people who created my life as it is, and it's unthinkable. I can only say that whatever it would have been, it wouldn't have been as good.
Have we another question? Thank you. We'll have this one and then
one
over here.
Helen, as somebody who tells stories, do you have a favourite? Would it be your most recent, or is it one that's as yet untold? Or your first story for a particular one?
I think as a story, The Railway Man has everything for me, because it is in itself an extraordinary, so the true story is remarkable. The extraordinary pleasure after 14 years of trying to get it made, of having Eric Lomax literally carried up the hill in Berwick-upon-Tweed when we were shooting it, and somebody saying to him, you know, you're really stuck with these filmmakers, Eric, over all these years. And he said, no, it's quite the opposite way around. They stuck by my story. And then to see the film have the impact it had. I say that it does a sort of honour to the families who had to cope. Patty Lomax now gets letters from people saying, thank you for explaining my father to me. And if you can make a film which, you know, you should never set out to make a film that might carry that kind of weight. But if you can find a story that is powerful in itself, but carries such waves of repercussions for other people, then I think that's about as good as film gets. And as I tell film stories, then I think I have to say that one. But it is like, who's your favourite child?
It says in the programme that you brought Kevin Spacey home for tea. When did that happen and how did it come about?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I missed out some of the stories. I was speaking without notes, like Mr. Miliband, so we made a film called Beyond the Sea. It was just after Girl with the Pearl Earring. Scarlett Johansson shares an agent with Kevin Spacey. So I'm just going to be shamelessly producer-y here. I was shopping for some food for a dinner party in Soho one Friday night when my phone rang. And there were some William Morris agents on the phone. And they said, you know, Andy, I gather, you know, you did a great job on Girl with the Pearl Earring. Kevin has this film that he's really passionate about. And to be honest, until he's made this film, we're never going to get him to be able to do anything else. But it's kind of tricky. And this was a movie about the singer Bobby Darin. And I read the script, got back on the phone with him, and I was pretty tough about some of the things I thought would have to happen if this was going to happen. Because Kevin wanted to, he'd written or rewritten it, he wanted to direct it, he wanted to act, he wanted to sing, he wanted to dance. And it was going to be a very, very tough thing. So I was pretty brutal about how I saw what would have to happen. And when I'd finished saying this, the agent said, could you say all that again? I thought, what do you mean? And then I realized that Kevin had just joined the conversation. So I thought, there's nothing to lose here, I should just say what I said, which of course Kevin being Kevin loved, because he needed somebody that was going to be able to help him through that extraordinary process. It was, I went that week to a read-through in Los Angeles, which Kevin being Kevin again, was up on the stage, Scarlett was reading the Kate Bosworth role, and at a certain point in the film, the Bobby Darin music would be played in. Except there was something strange about the Bobby Darin music, because of course I realised that it's actually Kevin, not Bobby Darin, but it was so good. It was completely amazing. The film was incredibly difficult to make. There's at least another hour of that story. But when we finished it, there were some things that were left undone. There was a sequence at the end of the film, which was in Big Sur in Northern California, where the disillusioned older Bobby Darin is kind of escaped from society before he's pulled back from the big emotional climax of the film. And we were shooting the movie, as you do, in Potsdam in Germany, it being set in Las Vegas, Manhattan, the south of France, and Big Sur. But we needed to do these pickups in Big Sur, and so I drove Kevin down to Dorset. And as we're driving through these beautiful, leafy English fields, he just kind of went, Paterson, what are we doing? And we drove down to Lulworth Cove, and I walked him up over the hill to one of my favourite places, which is Stair Hall. And he walked over, like one of those camera, you know, movie crane shots where you come over the hill, and there is this perfect Northern California coastline. And he kind of went, okay, this is great, we'll do it here. And the reason I know it so well is because my mother-in-law and father-in-law live 2 miles north of Lulworth Cove. So as we drove back, I said, we just have to stop for 5 minutes. And I just drove into their beautiful converted barn, and without being announced, so perfectly, there was my wife's mum and dad, and about six of their neighbours having tea. So I just walked Kevin in and said, hi, have you met Kevin? And we sat and had tea for half an hour, and then went home.
Have we another couple of questions just to finish off with? There's a question just here and one a little further back. Just take them one at a time and then we'll go.
Hi, what would your advice be to aspiring filmmakers?
Don't mess up your A levels. It's all about understanding the particular way that stories are told on film. You have to do, you know, what we did was just go, first of all, just, as we said, one camera, figure out the mechanics, but most of all, go and analyze when there's a film that you love, that grips you, that excites you, that whatever it does, figure out the structure, the beats, the tension. Ask yourself, why is it at this point that I'm so hooked to this film? Is it just because of the character? Is it because of the way that the story is withheld? And the simplest lesson is that you have to withhold information. When Sergeant comes down there and says, there's a telegram for you, don't follow the guy across the quad to open the telegram that says, awarded scholarship letter follows. Go somewhere else. You still want to know what's in that. Maybe you get to the point where you open the telegram, but you don't see it. Go somewhere else. The energy of movies is how you move it to the next stage, and every scene has to do more than just the literal thing. So, for me, to be able to see the pleasure it gave the people who had given me these opportunities was so immense. You don't often get the chance to stand on the stage and thank your parents. I won't make it too Hollywoodish, but what you have to do is say, okay, what does that telegram mean? To me, it meant they would be proud. So make that happen and then take the next bit. Always use the energy of the cut in the film and the tension of the film and go and analyze that on every movie you can ever see and work out why movies bore you and when they hook you. And if you can puzzle that out, you'll be a great filmmaker. Most people, you know, Mike said earlier on, you try not to make the same mistake twice, but it's really hard. And even when you've written it the way you want it, you can still have scenes that should do wonderful things but don't. And it's usually because you're not using that extra, those extra dimensions that film has. Study films.
And the final question.
In your opinion, who is the most interesting person that you've worked with and why?
Well, obviously Michael Hoffman, but leaving that aside. Okay, this may sound unlikely, but I think Harvey Weinstein, the man who ran Miramax, now runs the Weinstein Company. He's not always very pleasant. He's not always very subtle. But he financed restoration. That was the first film when he sold his company to Disney. He had enough money to fully finance, and so he was very, very passionate about the film. But he has more energy than anybody I've ever met. And for all his faults and his crudeness, he only cares about one thing, and that is getting a film to the biggest possible audience and figuring out why a film does or doesn't work. And as we've often said to him, he's very, very good at identifying problems with movies. He's terrible at solving them. But he will take that as an argument when you say, you tell us the problems, we'll solve them. And if we don't, you can do the things you do. But he works with the media, he works with his marketing people, he works with the filmmakers, and he makes mistakes like anybody else. But you know, he will call you at 2 o'clock in the morning and say, I'm meeting the film critic of the LA Times at 6, do you want to be there? To which the answer is, of course. This guy's working on your film so hard to try and get ahead. He drives you to try and make the film as good as possible. He often ruins films, but that's partly because people don't fight him. But he is a big mogul, man of a colossal imagination, worthy of the movies. You know, whatever the line is, the movies got smaller. I want movies to be huge. I want, you know, when you go and sit in the cinema, you want to come out feeling your life has changed, that you've just been through something immense. And he has that ambition. And very few people do. There are so many actors and directors and writers that I've worked with who are amazing. But as an answer, the movie business needs big characters. Otherwise, you know, we used to have a big problem that British movies got small. They got TV dominated. And, you know, there's a lot of different age groups in here, but movies used to be big. And you need big people to do that.
Thank you very much. I'd now like to call on the Vice Captain of School, Lewis Daly, to give us a vote of thanks.
evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is my privilege to have been asked to deliver the vote of thanks on this special occasion. On behalf of the students, staff, parents, governors, special guests, and on my own behalf, extend a very hearty thank you to Mr. Paterson for sharing with us his important work and imparting his advice on becoming a film producer. We are privileged to have someone who has travelled the world and worked with household names such as Sir Ian McKellen, of course a fellow old boy, and Colin Firth, and to have him here today in the hall in which he sat in his formative school days is very special to us. I'm sure the audience, myself included, have very much enjoyed this interesting and informative lecture. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being with us this evening for the 42nd Marcus Tillotson lecture.